The island of Sodor is a world of wonder. There are railways and engines and tales to be told.
Hello everyone, Joel Hunter here, aka Geeb Machine. With a partnership between my good friend and fellow voice actor, SmurfyDan, and Restore the Magic, a nonprofit organization focusing on the education of railways and media, we are creating a fan-made documentary focusing on the legacy and history of Thomas and Friends, with a comprehensive look back at the development of the stories, characters, and the future of the franchise. As your narrator for this special, I will be taking you through the entire lifespan of Thomas, from Mr. Awdry's early life to the new look of Thomas and Friends with Big World Big Adventures and beyond. In addition to Thomas, you will get an exclusive look into other shows inspired by Thomas and Friends, including Tugs and Shining Time Station. From the early start of a little handmade wooden toy to a global phenomenon, Thomas has inspired generations of children and adults alike for over 75 years, appearing in books and television and expanding to heritage railways and theme parks. The really useful engine is arguably the most recognizable train in the world. Although not everything about Thomas seems simple and innocent, especially with several controversies existing throughout the media.
All aboard for a big adventure!
Our journey begins with the life and works of the modest clergyman and family man who adored steam railways, inspiring the creation of the enchanting universe of the island of Sodor. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride through an in-depth retrospective fan documentary, Steaming to Legacy. Great Britain's long line of children's literature writers have come to be known around the world. These acclaimed authors made their names known for their iconic and lovable creations, such as Enid Blyton's Naughty, Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland, and A.A. Milne's Winnie the Pooh. However, there is one author who is not only one of the most recognized names in children's literature, but is also a well-respected clergyman and a keen railway enthusiast. The creation of this series of charming books would change his life. This man is the Reverend Wilbert Awdry. In the afternoon of June 15, 1911, in Romsey, Hampshire, Wilbert Vere Awdry was born to his parents, Vere and Lucy Awdry. Vere Awdry was a clergyman and a railway enthusiast. Much like his father, Wilbert had a sincere passion for steam trains since he was just a baby, as he recalled his first experience on a train to Salisbury in February 1912. Wilbert gained a younger brother with George Awdry, born on August 10, 1916. Soon after, the Awdry family moved to Box in Wiltshire called The Wilderness, located next to the Great Western Main Line from Paddington to Bristol. Wilbert and his father Vere often spent time together here, spotting passing trains using a telescope.
I remember we used to live in a house within 100 yards of the Great Western Main Line, where it climbs up from Box Station up through Box Tunnel up to Corsham, a gradient of about 1 in 100. And at night, as a small boy lying in bed, I'd hear a heavy freight come into Box Station. They'd crow for a banker, peep, 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 and the banker would come out of his little shed and buffer up behind. Peep, 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 I'm ready. And off they'd go. And in my imagination, I'd hear the two engines talking to each other. The goods engine, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it, I can't do it. And the anchor behind. Oh, yes, you can. Oh, yes, you can. Oh, yes, you can. And so they'd go on right up until the sounds of their argument were lost in the tunnel.
His unique experience would later be used as inspiration for what would become the story of the first two engines he brought to life many years later. Following his early years through education, his marriage with Margaret Emily Wale Awdry took place in 1938. Their first child, Christopher Vere Awdry, was born in Devizes Hospital on July 2, 1940. And shortly after, the new Awdry family moved to their first house together at King's Norton in South Birmingham during the Second World War.
My father was a curate in King's Norton in Birmingham, and my brother Christopher, who was about two at the time, was ill with measles.
And he had to be in a darkened room, and he wasn't allowed to use his eyes much. And we'd exhausted the entertainment value of most of the nursery rhymes we knew, but there were two which still rang a bell. One was the early in the morning down at the station, all little engines standing in a row. Well, I drew some engines standing in a row. I'm not much good at drawing, so I drew them the easiest way, head on. And there was blank space.
Hard work.
And the smoke boxes. So just for fun, I put little faces in.
It was a very simple picture. Six engines lined up in an engine shed. Front first, so they wouldn't have to bother about drawing the wheels. And they all had faces, and one of the faces was a sad one. And this drew, perhaps, the inevitable question, why is he sad, Daddy? Well, he said, he hasn't been out for a long time. Why hasn't he been out for a long time, Daddy? Well, the other engines are all bigger than he is, so the drivers choose them first. What's the engine's name, Daddy? Edward, he said. Anyone who knows the first couple of pages of Edward Stay Out, the first story, will probably recognise those answers as being incorporated in those first two pages. And it just grew from there. I obviously liked the story, so Father concocted another two.
Once upon a time, there was a little engine called Edward. He lived in a shed with five other engines. All bigger than Edward and boasted about it. The driver won't choose you again, they said. He wants big, strong engines like us. Edward had not been out for a long time. He began to feel sad. Just then, the driver and fireman came along to start work. The driver looked at Edward. Why, are you sad? He asked. Would you like to come out today? Yes, please, said Edward. So the fireman lit the fire and made a nice lot of steam. Then the driver pulled the lever and Edward puffed away. He whistled. Look at me now.
The stories were liked and we had to tell them over and over and over again. And as you've got to tell the story in the same way, using the same words, I wrote them down on the backs of old circulars. In my opinion, are much the best use for circulars.
So there was never any thought at this time, then, of publication being a possibility?
No. I thought they were just for family use.
So who persuaded you to publish them?
And then Mrs. Awdry thought they were worth something, and in the manner of wives, she stuck pins into me to do something about it.
I had seen books in shops, which I didn't think very much of, and went home and said to Wilbert, I think yours are quite as good as this, why don't you do something about it? But he said, what? You tell me. You see, of course, I didn't know anything about publishing or printing or anything, you see. I did rather push it, I think, because I did feel they were good. And, of course, unusual.
Well, there wasn't any time to write fair copies, so I had to send them these dirty scraps of paper.
After 2 years with several rejection letters due to wartime conditions, and with a helpful suggestion from his wife Margaret, Wilbert submitted his stories that he had written in 1943 to a publisher named Franklin Edmund Ward. Mr. Ward insisted that Wilbert write a fourth story that that would conclude the plots of Edward, Gordon, and Henry. On May 12, 1945, just 3.5 months before the war ended, The Three Railway Engines was published in Great Britain and became a success, selling 22,500 copies. The small book, which was perfect for small hands, contained four wonderful short stories about the adventures of three railway engines, Edward, Gordon, and Henry. But what about Thomas? He'll be showing up to the island shortly. The illustrations were provided by William Middleton, an inexperienced illustrator at the time, who was hired through printing connections by Edmund Ward. Because of his inexperience, the illustrations looked naturally unfinished and far too simplistic in terms of scale and drawing. The biggest mistakes included two tunnels of Ballyhoo instead of one, and Henry's wheel arrangement, which caused huge concerns, even for Wilbert. Eventually, Middleton was fired. From the 8th impression of the book in October 1949 onward, C. Reginald Dalby reproduced the illustrations to look more recognizable, and they still are today. However, the aforementioned mistakes by Middleton were also picked up in Dalby's illustrations, and would continue to cause further problems down the line. But in spite of the illustration miscommunications, the success of The Three Railway Engines prompted Wilbert to write a second volume to the series. This would feature Thomas in his very own book. These stories would follow Thomas's adventures from his start as a station pilot to becoming a really useful engine. Under the watchful eye of the fat director, of course. However, Thomas's debut came long before his first book appearance. He was based on a hand-carved wooden toy Wilbert made for Christopher on Christmas Day, 1942.
After the first stories, my father made Christopher a wooden engine, Edward, and Christopher apparently wanted Gordon, but that was too difficult to model. So tank engine from bits of wood, broomstick handle and things like that.
Which he happened to paint blue. It happened to have six wheels. He happened to have a one on the side painted. And in time, I asked for some stories about my engine. He then said, well, okay, yeah, I can make up stories about your engine, but before I can do that, your engine needs to have a name. Why don't we call him Thomas the Tank Engine?
Thomas was a tank engine who lived at a big station. He had six small wheels, a short, stumpy funnel, a short, stumpy boiler, and a short, stumpy dome.
In September 1946, the second book of the railway series, entitled Thomas the Tank Engine, was published. It became an instant success. These books had solidified these characters into children's literature and would launch one of the most popular children's franchise in history. Wilbert wrote a dedication to a certain young boy at the beginning of the second book. This forward message read,
Dear Christopher, here's your friend, Thomas the Tank Engine. He wanted to come out of his station yard and see the world. These stories tell you how he did it. I hope you will like them because you helped me make them. Your loving daddy.
Thomas was now the protagonist of his very own book. Taking a look at the illustrations, there are some differences between the wooden toy made by Wilbert and the very detailed tank engine that is featured in the book. Starting with the looks, the toy itself looked completely different as it was based on different engines. This could be the LNER J50 or the Hudswell Clark with much smaller and curved side tanks and splashers. The illustration of Thomas is based on a London, Brighton, and South Coast Railway E2 class tank engine, as illustrated by Reginald Payne, now redone by C. Reginald Dalby. The wooden toy also had two simple letters on the sides of Thomas's tank, N and W. This stands for Northwestern, although, ironically, Wilbert claimed at first that this stood for nowhere. But the illustrated Thomas had a different inscription on him, the number one. This was also painted on the side of Thomas's coal bunker on the wooden toy, differing from the illustrated version in comparison. But why did Thomas have the number one painted on his side? And why was Thomas the number one engine, whereas no other engine would have assigned numbers until 1951? One of Wilbert's daughters, Veronica Chambers, answers these questions.
Thomas got the number one for the simple reason that that was the easiest number to paint.
After the publication of Thomas the Tank Engine, Wilbert would continue to write more stories of Thomas, James, Percy, Edward, Henry, Gordon, Toby, and all of their friends on the island of Sodor. Most of Awdry's characters were based on real-life steam locomotives. Most notably, Toby is a special engine based on a J-70 steam tram.
Father always used to say that he didn't have favourites because the engines were all his family, and in a family you don't have favourites. They were his family, so I don't necessarily have the same restriction. No, Toby was my favourite always because a locomotive like Toby was in fact the first one that I was ever allowed to stand on way back in 1952, the August 1952. That was a very special thrill, obviously. And Toby is always the one that I've been most attached to.
And that is how Toby the Tram Engine came to be. The Fat Controller brought Toby and his faithful coach, Henrietta, to help on Thomas's branch line after Toby's old line was closed. Another example of real-life locomotives was Henry the Green Engine, whom Awdry had some issues with the character development. He was initially illustrated as a 442 Atlantic, but was changed to a 462 Pacific, similar to Gordon by William Middleton, much to Awdry's dismay. Further issues occurred with Dalby's illustrations, for Henry looked nearly identical to Gordon, which included his short-lived blue livery, square buffers, and inconsistent portrayal as a 460 instead of a 462. Awdry originally wanted to get rid of Henry, but by 1951, with the publication of Henry the Green Engine, he instead had him involved in a serious accident and rebuilt Henry into a Class 5 MT locomotive. Worse still, in early editions of the book, it contained a racial slur in the story Henry Sneeze. This went unnoticed until 1972, following the report from the National Press. Awdry issued an apology for the offense and changed the sentence to "as black as soot" in later editions that followed on. Most of Awdry's stories were inspired by real-life events on railways. Wilbert states that whatever happened to Thomas, Gordon, Henry, and the others had to have actually happened and have a railway-like explanation which fitted. One example includes the story Tenders and Turntables, where James was spun around on the turntable. This was inspired by an actual event at Hawes Junction.
"I mustn't stick," thought James anxiously as he ran to the turntable later. He stopped on just the right place to balance the table. It could now swing easily. His fireman turned the handle. James turned much too easily. The wind puffed him round like a top. He couldn't stop. At last the wind died down and James stopped turning, but not before Gordon, who had been turned on the loop line, had seen him. "Well, well," he said, "are you playing roundabouts?" Poor James, feeling quite giddy, rolled off to the shed without a word.
Another example is the climatic crash from A Close Shave, inspired by a real-life collision accident at a railway yard in Hull Station. Some of the stories Wilbert wrote were based on his own personal experiences, such as this. While working as a guard at the Teleflynn Railway, Awdry was responsible for leaving the refreshment lady, Mrs. Davies, behind. This would later be used as inspiration for the story, Peter Sam and the Refreshment Lady.
The last passengers arrived. The guard was ready with his flag and whistle. The refreshment lady walked across the platform. Then it happened. The guard says that Peter Sam was too impatient. Peter Sam says he was sure he heard a whistle. Anyway, he started. "Come quickly! Come quickly!" He puffed.
Stop, stop, stop!
Wailed the coaches.
You've left her behind! You've left her behind!
The guard whistled and waved his red flag. The driver, looking back, saw the refreshment lady shouting and running after the train.
Another example lies in the story Tit for Tat. The Reverend Teddy Boston, who appeared as the fat clergyman in the story, was indeed soaked by a steam train at the Ravenglass and Eskdale Railway, as precisely descriptive in the story itself.
Bert ran nicely till they reached the woods. The line climbs steeply here. Bert usually rushes the hill. This time, he deliberately dawdled. Come on, said his driver, giving him full steam. This was just what Bert wanted. Tit for tat, he shouted, storming up the slope. Rain-soaked branches met close overhead. Bert's blast, shooting straight up, shook them wildly. Showers of water fell on clergyman and driver. Their soaking did not stop till they had topped the rise, and steam could be reduced for the downward run.
But this begs the question. How did Wilbert recall his research on real-life railway incidents while coming up with new ideas for writing stories?
In the days before BR lost its sense of humour and couldn't laugh at itself, in the Railway Gazette, they had a delightful page which they called the Scrap Heap. And in it, there were offbeat incidents which had happened. One of them was a story of how years ago an engine was coming back light from some job when suddenly the ground beneath the track started giving way. And I used that as the basis for the story Thomas Down the Mine.
His driver stopped him and the fireman went to turn the points. Come on, waved the fireman, and they started. The driver leaned out of the cab to see where they were going. Now, said Thomas to himself, and bumping the trucks fiercely, he jerked his driver off the footplate. Hooray, laughed Thomas, and he followed the trucks into the siding. Stupid old board, said Thomas as he passed it. There's no danger, there's no danger. His driver, unhurt, jumped up. Look out, he shouted. The fireman clambered into the cab. Thomas squealed crossly as his brakes were applied. It's quite safe, he hissed. Come back, yelled the driver. But before they could move, there was a rumbling and the rails quivered. The fireman jumped clear. As he did so, the ballast slipped away and the rails sagged and broke. Fire and smoke, said Thomas. I'm sunk. And he was. Thomas could just see out of the hole, but he couldn't move. Oh dear, he said. I am a silly engine.
But we had to have a happy ending, so Thomas had to be able to be hauled out.
Is the happy ending important to your story?
Oh, the happy ending is important. The engine, however much it's misbehaved, has got to express sorrow and be restored.
Beginning with the three railway engines and ending with tramway engines, Wilbert wrote a total of 105 engine stories until his semi-retirement in 1972. And while writing, he also served his time as the rector of Ellsworth in Knapwell in Cambridgeshire from 1946 to 1953. And for the next 12 years, he became the vicar of Enmyth until 1965, when he retired from full-time ministry. And around this time, Very Old Engines was published to celebrate the centenary of Taliflin Railway, with acknowledgments from the members of the Railway Preservation Society. From this point thereafter, Wilbert moved to Stroud in Gloucester, where he spent his final years. But more on that later. In addition to the Railway series, which was aimed at young audiences, Wilbert penned two novellas of a spin-off called Belinda the Beetle, aimed at a much older audience. The first title was written and published in 1958, and was followed by a sequel, Belinda Beats the Band, a decade later. Although the engine stories have received much recognition since 1945, Belinda sadly did not. Those interested in Awdry's engine stories are encouraged to also explore Belinda's stories as well. From Thomas's first appearance in 1946, readers would continue to follow the adventures of their favorite tank engine. And over the years, many engines would be introduced to work on the island of Sodor. There are numerous stories to be told, and this legacy has only just begun.